Good evening, everyone. Let me ask you to be turning to Luke, the fifth chapter, if you would, please. Luke 5. I'm going to share some things, at least initially from the text there, as we look at this lesson tonight about anchored in purpose. I hope that you have had a good day. I have had a good day. It's been more of the same. Eat, eat, and eat. And it has been good, as it's been good every day. Sister Mary fed me tonight. So if I'm a little wobbly, you'll know why. I'll just leave it at that. I'll just leave it at that. Is that good, Mary? I said that about right? Okay, good. All right. Really, really good to be here. It has been a good day. I want you to read along with me. I'm hoping that the font that I have is big enough for me to read. See, that's pretty small, but I'm just going to turn around here. I'm closer to it. Let's read this text from Luke 5 as we think about some things that relate to anchored in purpose. And this is the lesson that all the kids are going to talk about tonight. And I want to begin here tonight because I think this has a lot to do with some things that are important for us to think about as we think about anchoring our lives. I begin in verse 1 of Luke 5. So it was, as a multitude pressed about him to hear the word of God, that he stood by the lake Gennesaret and saw two boats standing by the lake. But the fishermen had gone from them and were washing their nets. Then he got into one of the boats, which was Simon's, and asked him to put out a little from the land. And he sat down and taught the multitudes from the boat. When he had stopped speaking, he said to Simon, "Launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch." But Simon answered and said to him, "Master, we have toiled all night and caught nothing. Nevertheless, at your word, I will let down the net." When they had done this, they caught a great number of fish, and their net was breaking. So they signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both the boats so that they began to sink. When Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying, "Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord." For he and all who were with him were astonished at the catch of fish which they had taken. So also were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid. From now on you will catch men." So when they had brought their boats to land, they forsook all and followed him. I want to ask you one question about that story, and here's the question. Can you relate to that story? There's very little about that story I can relate to. I read it, I see it, and I see it happening, but it's hard for me really to relate to that story. I have never been with Jesus in the flesh. I have never had a particular fishing experience like Peter had and those other men who were with them. And I've never changed jobs and occupations as quickly as these men changed their job, their purpose, and their occupation. And I've never left everything that I owned and everybody I loved, what I would say, immediately. And that's exactly what these men did. They went from fishermen to fishers of men. And their life and their purpose in life changed, and it really changed instantaneously. Are we called to do that? Would you say that we're called to do what they were called to do? I see some yes, and I see some no. Could that question that I've asked be answered yes and no? Yes and no. Okay. Yeah. I think it's a hard question. And I think it's a hard question for various reasons. But that is the question that I want to ask. Does this fishers of men concept even apply to Christians today? Does it apply to us? Think about this. None of us are apostles. None of us are apostles. None of us has been called to preach and teach the way they were called to preach and the way that they were called to teach. I'm certainly not called to preach like they preach. To my knowledge, maybe you've never thought about this, but I don't know that they ever had to study. You ever thought about that? When they were told to go out and preach, what were they told was going to happen to them? Spirit was going to give them the word. Well, I've been looking for that to happen, and it ain't happened yet. Okay? Not in that sense, for sure. Okay? So there are some things, obviously, that are different. A few were teachers. All of them were teachers, you know, but none of us have been apostles. Most of us are not preachers. A few more are teachers. And even a few more might be compelled to teach Jesus to an unbeliever. But relating to this story, I think, is very difficult. They were apostles, and I'm not. And for all the things that I mentioned to you. And I think there is a sense in which I cannot relate to this story. But there is clearly a lesson to be learned. And I think the lesson for us that I want us to move in tonight, and I want us to think about this from a biblical perspective, is that yes, we are called to have a changed life, and we're called to have a life that is purposeful in terms of teaching people the gospel. When you think of the fifth letter of the New Testament, what is it? This is time for test. What is it? Acts what? Acts of the Apostles. I think that's misnamed. Why would I say that might be misnamed? What? All right, there's a sense in which they are the Acts. The Holy Spirit certainly guided them and helped them to do those Acts. That's true. Why else might I think that's misnamed? Well, it's not Acts of all the Apostles. It's Acts of the Apostles. It's not all the Acts. Certainly all the Apostles. It's not even a few of the Acts of all of the Apostles. It's not even a few of the facts of a few of the Apostles. Is it? Not really. Knowing the road I'm going down now, how would you then think I might want to name that particular letter, Luke? It's a few Acts of two apostles primarily. Not exclusively, but it's basically a few things that Peter and Paul did with the help of John every now and then. You follow what I'm saying? But what Acts is, and I'm not, please don't misunderstand me, I'm not arguing with the way it's been named because I understand what we're saying. But it gives the sense that this was what all the apostles did. The apostles are named in the book of Acts, but they're named initially, and then it just kind of narrows itself down pretty good. Where really the primary character in the book of Acts is whom? It's Paul. It really is Paul. Once you begin his story, you know, there in Acts 9, I mean, once you get to that story at the end of Acts 8, then that's pretty much what it is. It's the story of Paul. But it's really has to do with this history of what happened in the early church. That's really what we're talking about. And it's a book about the gospel being shared with people. And it's interesting that gospel that's shared in the book of Acts, while the apostles, and particularly Peter and Paul, may be the ones that are named, but everybody's sharing in that. I want us to look at that in just a moment. We're going to kind of take a focal point from there in just a moment. But I want you to notice something that I find interesting, very interesting, about the book of Acts. These are the last two verses in the book of Acts. And Luke says, "Then Paul dwelt 2 years in his own rented house, and received all who came to him, preaching the kingdom of God and teaching the things which concern the Lord Jesus Christ with all confidence, no one forbidding him." Does that seem like kind of an odd way to end a letter? There's no right or wrong answer. To me, it seems a little odd that it just closes that way. Peter, or rather Paul, is now in Rome. He has appealed to Caesar. And because he's appealed to Caesar, he now eventually makes his way to Rome, okay? Not without some issues that we're going to look at a little bit tomorrow night when we talk about some of the shipwreck that he incurred. But he makes his way to Rome, and he's there. He spends 2 years in a rented house, and he's able to teach, and he's able to preach. And it just closes by saying, He was teaching the things which concern the Lord Jesus Christ with all confidence, no one forbidding him. Now this letter that Luke wrote to Theophilus, this second letter that Luke writes, he writes this to help him understand some things about the church. That's the way this ends. Why do you think it ends that way? Or what could be a possibility that it ends this way here? If this is the history of the church, this is what I tell the folks where I preach regularly. You got to think like me, please. It helps me because I'm not a very good question asker. So it's better if you'll just kind of jump into my head and think what I'm thinking. That always helps me, okay? But why might it end this way? Excellent point. It's just the beginning, and I don't even know, obviously Paul was able to be released. Even at this point, he was able to go and do other work and eventually probably end back up in Rome. But this is not the end. Think about this. When does the book of Acts, in theory, end for you? When does it end for you? That's not a trick question. See, that's another one of my bad questions. It ends when you die. When does it end for me? When I die. Why? Because I'm part of the church. Because you're part of the church. And you're writing your section, in essence, of the book of Acts. I want you to begin thinking about that. When you read what Paul does here, and when it stops, in essence, what he's saying is, this is what Luke's saying, this is what was happening to Paul at this point in time in his life. But you and I continue to write the history of the church because we're part of it, you see. We're part of it. And we continue to work because we continue to do some of the things that these men were asked to do. We do continue to teach and we do continue to help. But Acts really closes open-ended because we're writing our own ending to the book of Acts. Now, obviously it's not inspired, and I realize that, but that's what we're really trying to do. We are involved in the history of the church. I want to ask you this question. What does your part of church history look like evangelistically? I'm getting very personal with you now. You see what Paul was doing? Paul was teaching. Paul was preaching things concerning the kingdom of God, things which concern the Lord Jesus Christ with all confidence, no one forbidding him. That's what he was doing. That's how he was writing. That was what I could say about him. This is how Paul was acting evangelistically. Let me ask you a question. What are you doing evangelistically? And we're going to ask an even more questions is, how important is that? Because I think what we're talking about now is the purpose that we have. We're going to look at more at this. But the purpose that we have is primarily a spiritual purpose. If I ask you what's your purpose in life, how many answers do you have to that? How many answers do any of us have to that? Don't you have multiple purposes in your life? Don't you have multiple things that you're involved with, responsibilities that you have, and purposes that you have to fulfill? But the focal point of our life obviously has to be this spiritual purpose. And what I want to do tonight is just to make a few observations then that have to do with how we view our lives. And I'm going to use the term evangelistically. When I ask that question, let me ask it a different way. When I say, how many people in your life have you affected evangelistically for the sake of helping them know more about Jesus or teaching them the gospel? Does that give you pause? It gives most people pause. Because most people that I have found, myself included, don't feel as good about the answer that I might give to that. And generally when I ask that question, I get people looking at me like you're looking at me. And while I can't read your mind, I understand that makes you somewhat sensitive because it makes me sensitive when I think about what's happening as well and what I've done in my life. So I want us to talk a little bit about that tonight. And I want us to look at it by just thinking about four reasons why we're all evangelists. And I've even had people ask the question, and I think it's a legitimate question. How much responsibility do we have to be fishers of men? Is that a good question for us to ask? If the story we just read, if we can't relate to that, then how do we put ourselves in an environment in our lives and say, you know, I have some responsibility to that, and I am responsible to God and to others for helping with that. So I want us just to think about that for a few minutes tonight. Well, the first thing I would say is that we are all witnesses. We are all people who, sometimes we use the word witness. Why don't we like to, I think a lot of us don't like to use that word. Why is that typically? Well, because we didn't see it happen. But does a witness have to see it happen? What kind of witness needs to see it happen? An eyewitness. That makes us different than the apostles who were the eyewitnesses. But I am a witness because a witness can attest to a fact, right? That's what a witness is called to do. Now, an eyewitness has to attest to the fact that he or she saw that. But a witness just needs to attest to the fact. Turn over to 1 John. Let's look at that passage. We'll look at the first four verses of 1 John. And I think in that we can kind of see the difference of what we're talking about. This is 1 John 1. Listen to what John writes. He says, that which was from the beginning, which we have heard, which we have seen with our eyes, which we have looked upon and our hands have handled concerning the word of life. The life was manifested and we have seen and bear witness and declare to you that eternal life which was with the Father and was manifested to us. That which we have seen and we have heard we declare to you, that you also may have fellowship with us, and truly our fellowship is with the Father and with His Son Jesus Christ. What does John say we did? We heard Him. We touched Him. We saw Him. They were eyewitnesses. He says, but we write to you. We're letting you know about our eyewitness testimony. Verse 4 says, so that your joy may be full. So that you can have fellowship. So that you can share in what we have. What John is saying is, you may not have seen Him, but we want you to be so confident in the facts as we know them to be because we saw Him. We want you to be so confident that it's as if you can witness for Him as well. That your joy may be full. That you may, the word that John uses, he uses it twice in the section that we've just read, that you can declare that Jesus was who He said it was. You can declare that. That's to pronounce that. And to state that and to proclaim that. And that's what he says, I hope that you can do because you believe our eyewitness testimony. And all of us then, in that sense, if we believe the evidence and if we can attest to that, no, we haven't seen Jesus. But don't you believe that He existed? And aren't you willing to tell people that He existed? And aren't you willing to attest to the fact that, yes, you can witness for Him because you can attest to that? No, you're not an eyewitness. But you can tell people who Jesus was. So that's the first thing that I would suggest is that's why we're all evangelists, because we believe so strongly in what the evidence would show and what the eyewitnesses saw. I love to think about just that whole concept about what the eyewitnesses would have seen. And then secondly, let me suggest this. The first century Christians were all witnesses. Some of those obviously were eyewitnesses, but not all, okay? But some of them were witnesses. I want you to think about two passages. Acts 8 chapter and verse 4. By the time we get to Acts 8, as Luke writes this, really we have been dealing with, and you know this from your own study, we've really just been dealing with what happened in the church at Jerusalem up until this point. And when the text says those who were scattered went everywhere preaching the word, why were the Christians scattered at this point? Persecution. They were scattered because of persecution. Remember what happened in Acts the 7th chapter and what begins again continues to talk about in Acts 8 with the stoning of Stephen and all of this where the church was begin to be scattered. And the text tells us that those who were scattered went everywhere preaching the word. When you get to Acts 11 and verse 19, the text says, "Now those who were scattered after the persecution that arose over Stephen traveled as far as Phoenicia, Cyprus, and Antioch, preaching the word to no one but the Jews only." I want to make an observation to you. The history of the church that's recorded in the book of Acts is that history, I think, primarily because of what every disciple was doing. Because of what every disciple was doing. Yes, we have a record of the apostles. They had a unique responsibility. Yes, they were leaders. Yes, Paul was leading. He was leading in those journeys. And he had men who would travel with him. And yes, they were leading. But there were so many people involved in the process. So many people who were teaching and trying to reach people with the gospel. That's what was going on. As a matter of fact, let me mention this quote to you. I think I've got this quote up here. This Kenneth Scott Lollaret said this. This is the history of the expansion of Christianity. It was written in 1937. But I saw this quote and I thought it was really good. He said, "The chief agents of the expansion of Christianity appear not to have been those who made it a profession or a major part of their occupation, but it was the men and women who earned their livelihood in some secular manner and spoke of their faith to those whom they met in this natural fashion." You know who he's talking about? He's talking about the common man. I'm not trying to put one above the other, but he's talking about, for lack of a better term, he's just talking about the ordinary Christian, the ordinary disciple. When I was involved in my secular work in Tampa, oftentimes when I would travel, and when I would fly, I'd get on a plane. If I was, you know how when you get on a plane, you know, people, you can tell pretty quick when you sit on. Do you think these people want to talk, or do you think they don't want to talk? And the better question is, do you want to talk, or do you not want to talk? Now, that's one of the big questions. But when I would sit down, and when somebody would, you know, next to me, you get kind of comfortable. And what's one of the quick first questions that people ask? What do you do? What do you do? If I wanted to talk, I'd tell them I was a college athletic director. If I didn't want to talk, what did I tell them I did? I'm a preacher. That'll shut it down. And if it doesn't, you're going to be talking longer than you ever wanted to talk. That's right. But I find that interesting. Don't you? I want to tell you something else that I have found interesting. This is just me. This is just my take. But my reaction or my observation about people who are willing to talk about the Bible are much more willing to talk about it with me if they know I'm not a preacher. You believe that? Let me tell you something, folks. That's the truth. I'm not suggesting that it's bad to be a preacher. I hope that's not the case. But I think there's some people who see preachers as, well, you know what? That you're selling something. You're promoting something. And if you can help, me become that, then it kind of promotes you. I can't believe that people would actually believe that, but sometimes that's the case. What little success that I've had in reaching people with the gospel, I think, happened more so then than maybe it even does now. And I will tell you this. I have done a few things in my life that caused me to have great joy, that have been pleasurable moments in my life where something has happened and I thought, man, that is a good thing to be part of. I've coached and I've played in sports and I've had these moments where, you know, I've reached what I thought was the pinnacle. And I've won a great game. I can remember, you know, in my early coaching days, you know, we won a big game and I thought, man, this feeling's going to last for months and this feeling's going to last for years. And it lasted till I got home. And that's about it. It's like, well, there it goes. You know, I got, like I was talking about Sunday, I got the reward. If that's what I wanted, that's what I've got. But the greatest thing is to sit down with a Bible and look across the desk or the table or the kitchen table with someone who's interested in finding out what the Bible says. that's ever happened to you where you were there and you were talking to somebody about the Bible, and as you're studying with them, as you're reading, as you're talking to them, you see the light come on. And some of my favorite words to hear, I see that. I get that. I want that. I have to have that. My most favorite memories. And in my mind right now, even as I tell you that story, I'm thinking of different people who have had influence by me and on me and to me in my life because we've had those conversations. Those are wonderful periods of time in our lives because those are the things, obviously, that are most valuable. But in between Acts, the 8th chapter in verse 4, and Acts the 11th chapter in verse 19, there are four, I want you to think about this, there are four conversion stories. I'm not going to take the time to talk about everything about this that we could, but I want you to think about the four conversion stories that start in Acts the 8th chapter. Remember Philip went down to Samaria? And you remember what the text says? Was the gospel well received in Samaria? Yeah. Men and women believed. A man named Simon believed. A man named, we sometimes call Simon the sorcerer, believed. But who were the Samaritans? How would you define or how would you classify the Samaritans in terms of how the first century world felt about them? Outcast. They were outcast. They were, in essence, to use a term that's probably not the right term to use, but it explains, it articulates it, they were half-breeds. And yet, the one place that he starts, that Luke starts in talking about people converted, is that Jesus went into Samaria. That's what he did. Or that's John 4. But here, obviously, others were going into Samaria, and Philip was told to go in Samaria and preach the gospel. And that's what happened. And yet, they were half-breeds. They would be the easiest people necessarily to reach. And then you get to the Ethiopian eunuch in the latter part of Acts the 8th chapter. Who was the eunuch? He was a man who, for the purpose of rendering work and security for the king, he was a man who would have been mutilated. To use the specific term, he was a man who would have been castrated so that he could fulfill some duties that the king wanted done because he could trust the eunuch. And Acts 8 tells us a story about a man who, if he had gone to Jerusalem, he could have gone to Jerusalem, but he could have not gotten close to the temple because of who he was. And yet, through the providence of God, he meets a man who teaches him the gospel. That was the eunuch. And Deuteronomy tells us that eunuchs were expressly forbidden from the temple and from other places where people of God would meet. And yet, the story that Luke tells is that the one of a eunuch was one who was converted. And you get to Acts 9, and you have a man who is a pronounced enemy of Christianity. What was his name? Saul. A pronounced enemy, and yet he is converted. And then you get to Acts 10, and who do you have? You have Cornelius, who is a Gentile. I want you to think about, these are the four conversion stories that are found from Acts 8:4 to Acts 11:19. What might be the reason that Luke used those four conversion stories in that parenthesis? What do you think he's trying to help us see? Church is for all. The gospel is for all. And that's a lesson from an us being fishers of men. That's certainly a lesson that every single one of us need to understand, that the gospel is for all. And everyone is lost. And I just make that point about this because I think that that's why he mentions these four illustrations. He said everybody needs to hear the gospel. And in these four cases, these four examples, these four people heard the gospel and they were converted. But we need to share the gospel at every opportunity we have. Consider the stewardship that the gospel imposes on us. I want you to look at this text. This is 2 Corinthians, the 5th chapter. For the love of Christ compels us because we judge thus, that if one died for all, then all die. And he died for all, that those who live should live no longer for themselves, but for him who died for them and rose again. Therefore, from now on, listen to this. Therefore, from now on, we regard no one according to the flesh. And let me just stop right there. If Paul says, from now on, we regard no one according to the flesh, how would you think they regarded anyone? It's not according to the flesh. What's it according to? Not everybody at once. The Spirit. They see everybody from a spiritual point of view. Even though we have known Christ according to the flesh, yet now we know Him thus no longer. We don't look at people the same way. And it's because of what he says in verse 14, the love of Christ compels us. And because the love of Christ compels, and some translations say it controls us, and because of that, we don't see men the same way. We don't see these who are lost the same way. And I'm asking you to think about this with me tonight, just to try to motivate all of us to be more like those, even those apostles who were trying to reach people with the gospel. Some of you probably remember Brent Hunter. Brent, I think, preached here. He preached not far from here with a church for a few years. At least that's my recollection. Brent's mother and father worshiped with us in Tampa, where I preached and worked for over 30 years. Walt and Louise Hunter. Louise is still alive. Walt passed several years ago. Walt Hunter always saw people according to the Spirit. He and others, but he especially, taught me so much about seeing people. And the first thought when I saw people was to think about them spiritually and not according to the flesh. I want to give you a great example. As I said, Walt and Louise worshiped with us at the University Church. They were coming to the building one day to work in the resource room, which they did on a pretty regular basis. And when he got out of his car one morning, he saw a man and a woman walking on Bruce B. Downs Boulevard there in front of the building, our building. And Walt hollered at the guy and said, "Hey," said, "we're going to have worship here Sunday. Why don't you come?" Now, I want to ask you a question. If you'd gotten out of your car and you saw two people walking on the road and you said that to them, what do you think the chances of them showing up on Sunday would be? Yeah, slim and none. The guy yelled back, "We'll be there." Sunday morning, you know who was there? Sergio and Selah Chavez. The two people that Walt had hollered at when he got out of his car. If I'd been walking on the street and a man hollered at me, it probably scared me to death. But they were there. And not only were they there, but at the end of that service, and Walt was looking for him, which didn't surprise me at all. And he introduced him to me, and he introduced him to some other people. And Walt, by the end of that service, before they went back home, Walt had taken them out to eat. Walt had already asked them for a Bible study, and they said yes, they would. And Walt began to study with them and began to invite me to come into them and study with them. And soon after we began to study with them, both of them obeyed the gospel. Now here's the second part of the story that it gives me chill bumps. About 3 years after Sergio and Selah, maybe not even that, after they'd obeyed the gospel, Sergio came to me one morning and he said, "Kenny," he said, "I'd like to ask you to do something for me." I said, "Sure." He said, "Would you go to Costa Rica and teach my family?" Well, you know what I said. I said, "Sure. I'd be glad to. I'd be more than glad to." And I made two trips within a few months. I made two trips to Costa Rica with the express purpose of trying to reach his family, brothers, sisters, cousins, that sort of, trying to reach his family with the gospel. They were somewhat religious, but they weren't living according to what the truth of the gospel is. And he understood that, and he wanted them to hear that gospel. Well, none of his family was ever converted, but while we were there, we started meeting with a group of people who were the church in Alajuela, Costa Rica. And since that time that Walt said to Sergio and Sayla, "How about coming to church Sunday?" I've made 12 trips to Costa Rica to try to help those brethren reach other brethren with the gospel. I'm not the only one who goes, and I'm not the only one who does that. But what I want you to see is when people look at people according to the Spirit and not always according to the flesh, look what wonderful things can be done. And many of you could tell me similar stories. And that's what I want you to see. We've got to be people. We've got to be people who are willing to talk to people, who give people an opportunity to either accept or reject the gospel. That's what fishers of men do. I don't have a lot of information that says this is a technique and this is a method and this is what all of us need to be doing. But I will say it to you this way before my time runs out. I believe those who are the best evangelists, this is not going to surprise you when you know my background. It's like a person who's a good rebounder in basketball. You know the best rebounders in basketball? You know what it takes to be a good rebounder in basketball? It takes you wanting to rebound the basketball more than the other 9 people who are on the court at that time. That's what it takes. There was a point in time in my coaching career where I just quit coaching technique. I quit coaching box it out. I just said, go get it. And the people who were the best at that were the people that went to get it. He's not the greatest moral example, but that's exactly what Dennis Rodman was when he played. He didn't score much, couldn't handle the ball, didn't shoot it very often, but when the ball went up, he knew what his purpose was. And his purpose was go get the rebound. And he was great at it. I wouldn't say he was great at a lot of other things, but he was sure great at that. And it's because he wanted that. And that's what those who want to teach the gospel, that's what those who want to be fishers of men, that's what they do. They're the people who want to go out and do that. And I want to suggest to you folks that all of us have that opportunity and that obligation to do that to some degree or another. And again, I don't have all the answers about methods and all of that. But if you want to do that, if you want to be a person who can do that and is willing to do that, God can use you in that area. We all to some degree are fishers of men. And I don't want to be one on the day of judgment that God looks at and he says, why weren't you willing to speak up? Why weren't you willing to do what Walt Hunter did? Why weren't you willing to say to that person, hey, come and join us. Are you interested in studying the Bible? What do you think about faith? What do you think about Jesus? What do you think about God? And us ask these questions. And so I don't have any great magic pill to pass out tonight to say, if you want to be a fisher of men, take this 2 times a week and it's going to make you better. I don't have that, but I would say to you, if that's what you want to be, you can be that. And God needs you to be that. God needs to equip the saints for the work of ministry. Ephesians 4 tells us that he does that by having pastors and by having teachers and by having others who can help. But this is going to take all of us. And if the church here at Eastland is going to continue to grow, let me tell you how it's going to be. It's going to be all of you doing what you can. And it's going to be those of you whose name is not Scott Byer. It's going to be those of you whose name is not Phil Morris or Scott Boatwright or John Bingham. It's going to be those of you who are not those men. They have a responsibility. They have a role to play. You've asked them to play that role. But it's not going to be because of them that this church really grows. They've got a very important responsibility. And I can't express to you how important leadership is and good teaching is. I cannot tell you how important that is. But what's really going to make this church grow is you. That's the way that is. And all of us have this obligation, obviously, to be fishers of men. I've got about 5 minutes. Good. All right, so here's what I want to do. I want to ask this question. What hinders us? I'm not trying to say that this church is hindered, but generally speaking, and you think about it yourself, you can think about just how you generally feel, but what hinders us? What are some things that hinder us from not being people that are willing to do this more than we do? So let's just throw out some ideas real quick. What's one thing? What? Lack of knowledge, okay? We don't have the knowledge, okay? We'll just come back. So, lack of knowledge. How do we solve that problem? I love the simplicity. It's exactly right. We read, we study, right? We gain the knowledge. And I'm not saying everybody has the same knowledge, and there's going to be situations where you need greater knowledge or where you need someone with greater knowledge. You've got that, right? So that's not something we can say, you know, that's a hindrance, that's why, not why we do it, and we really can't correct that. We can't. We might get rejected, right? Anybody here never been rejected? I don't want to get too personal. But all of us have been rejected, right? That's a factor. We're afraid of that. Why would we be afraid of that? Why would we be afraid of that? We got to get past that. What's another reason? What? As in what? Okay. Could lose a job. Could lose a relationship. Is it important to have a job? Is it important to have a relationship? Yes. What's most important? People hear the gospel, right? And again, we have to balance ourselves. I get that. I understand that. Okay. What else? Can you think of anything else? We're shy. We're just shy. Okay. You sometimes wish you were a little bit more gregarious so that you might speak up. My brother-in-law was visiting, he and his wife, who's my sister, were visiting Beth and me in Tampa one day, and I was going out to run some errands, and I said, Jimmy, come and go with me. I had to pick up a couple of shirts at the cleaners. I walked in, he came in behind me. I thought, well, I'll just be a few minutes, but he came in, and while I'm standing there waiting for this girl to pick up my shirts, another lady was there, and there was a picture on the back wall of somebody that apparently, that was a picture of Jesus. It was clear that that's who that was supposed to be. I'm sitting there waiting on my shirts to be picked up, and Jimmy said, "Oh, do you know who Jesus is? I'm the local preacher. I'm standing there waiting on my shirts." Jimmy said, "Do you know who that is?" She said, "Yeah, yes, sir, that's Jesus." He said, "Do you believe in Jesus?" "Yes, sir, I do. I'm still waiting on my shirts." He said, "Well, my brother-in-law is named Kenny. This is Kenny, and he preaches for the church right down here." And I'm sitting there feeling about that tall. And Jimmy's trying to convert this woman. He lives in Connecticut. He's just visiting for 3 days. You think that made an impression on me? You bet it did. I hadn't forgotten it. It's been a long time. I hadn't forgotten it. Why? Because he was just willing to say something. Just willing to say something. He carried on a conversation with the lady. He found out where she'd gone to church. I'm hearing it all. I'm taking it all in. But I'm just wishing I'm the one who'd started it. But he taught me something. Taught me something. Anything else? Can we do more? Yeah, go ahead. Yeah, okay. Yeah. Again. They're coming again and want to talk to me about the Bible. Okay? Now you got to be balanced, right? You know, I'm not going to beat anybody over the head to study the Bible, but I want to make sure I give them some opportunities, right, to hear about it, right? Fishers of men, folks. It's a spiritual purpose that we all have. We've got other responsibilities. I get that. I'm fully aware of that. I do too. But we've got to keep this spiritual purpose that we've got to try to reach people with the gospel. And if we'll continue to do it, not just the preachers and the elders, please understand, this has got to be everybody. When everybody's involved, it goes well. Okay, here they come, so I'm going to shut her down.